So let me begin by introducing Jack Cooke.
Oh, yes.
Jack is the guy who films most of my handstand events. So he's the man behind the camera. He's the secret weapon that that makes my workshops look great. So how are you doing today, JD?
Yeah, I'm doing good. Yeah, I had a really good day yesterday. So feeling sort of, you know, there's a little skip in my step at the moment. So yeah, very good.
So give us an overview of your business is called Beyond the Brand, and tell us what you do for people. What do you do?
Well, you got the standard that comes with videography. You know, anybody could pick up a camera and edit. You know, I do the promos, I cover events, do coverage, get testimonials for businesses, do the interviews, etc. But Beyond the Brand is actually a passion project as well. And I'm very excited about what people do, entrepreneurs and business owners, and even hobbyists that, have a really good interest in what they do and why they do it. And Beyond the Brand is about getting going beyond the brand, and bringing out these stories through the power of video. So I do go into businesses and, I set up and ask questions and I develop content for social media that really talks about who these people are.
So you focus on video marketing for businesses, and I mean, you film events, you film interviews, you go behind the scenes in their business, and you'll put together like promotional material that's going to help them with their online presence.
Yeah, absolutely. I think social media is the tool now, in this day and age, and anybody that tries to hide away from it, I'm sorry, they're gonna lose out 100%. You gotta ride that wave. And what a lot of people are doing are there's a lot of hard selling on social media, and people aren't really sort of giving insight to who they are or why people should care about them. So for me, I like to create content that genuinely gets people to appreciate the business owners and the brand, and essentially passively sell their products through just being, themselves on camera.
I know from myself that having great videos, it does save you a lot of time, because if you can send somebody a link and the video shows what you do, it shows what you got, it's a great time saver, because it saves me having to explain to people over and over again, my name's Ben, I teach handstands. No, it is, it is this, it's not that, when people see a video of what you offer, they instantly get it. There's no explanation required. So it's a massive leverage on time.
Absolutely. There is that, and it's, people get to know who you are. It sets you apart. But also the biggest thing as well, which people don't sort of think about, is that actually somebody might not want to work with you, but you've made that decision before either of you got into a conversation and wasted your time. They've already established whether they take to you or not, whether they want to work with you. And it saves you time in that as well, in the fact that once people understand exactly who you are, and how you come across, they'll decide whether they want to work with you or not instantly. And that just saves everyone a lot of hassle. And I think video is very powerful for that. You can hide behind words of a blog, an image. But with video, it's raw, it's there, it's everything that you are, within, a minute's worth of video.
Yeah, I think that's true. There's something special about video. It's like the next best thing to being with someone in person.
Yeah.
And that's different to just reading a description. And I think if you've got a good video of yourself talking about what you do, you can build trust and rapport with people via video. Even though you've not met them, they feel like they've met you. And I've been doing videos for a long time. I first started in 2006 when I started with the online guitar lessons. And so, I've been doing it a long time. And I mean, it doesn't happen often, but sometimes people will come up to me and they'll say, I saw your video. And I mean, I'm not famous or anything. I'm not some celebrity, but I can really tell that they feel like they know me already. And it's a weird thing, but video is that powerful.
Well, I get it a lot now, because I do a lot of networking in and around Bristol and a little further afield as well. And I've got quite a community on LinkedIn now, and I've been developing my own personal videos, my own Beyond the Brand stuff for a little while now, just taking my GoPro out and doing vlogs. And I did one, I've done a few and I still get mentions, but I did one where I was ill for a day, and I thought, as an entrepreneur and business owner, if you're ill, you know, what you go through, you know, when you want to work, when you want to get on with your business. And I filmed a little video because I thought that would speak and resonate with a lot of people. And I'm still yesterday, so a few, about 2 months ago, yesterday I was at an event and somebody said, I saw that video where you were ill and are you all right now? I'm like, well, yeah, it was only a day and that was 2 months ago, but I appreciate you asking. People I don't know.
Yeah.
And that's amazing. Absolutely amazing.
And excuse me. So there's so much, I got several questions in my mind that is lined up. So, give us some practical tips in terms of, let's imagine somebody's listening to this and they might be self-employed. Yep. And they might not have much marketing going on. And they might be nervous about creating videos. You know, I've spoken to a lot of people like that.
Yes.
It's like they know they should do it, but they're not sure. And they don't know what equipment they should buy. And they don't know if they should get like some professional lighting. They got no idea where to start. It's just like overwhelmed. They don't know where to begin. So give us some tips.
Okay. Well, first off and foremost, you don't need anything but the phone in your pocket. Too many people are just going, I need the lighting. I need to build this grand strategy. I need to, buy all the best equipment, microphones and all that. I'm sorry, but technology is so advanced now that you could use your phone to promote your business and do very, very well. How I would play that is, first of all, what questions do you get asked every day by your customers, no matter how small? Put a pen and pad of paper next to your laptop, tablet, phone, whatever you've got, and write down these questions. That's your content. Every question, answer it within a video. Get your phone out. You might want to put it on a stand or a tripod in front of you and on your desk. Hit the record button. Start with the question. Answer the question. And then throw that out onto social media, because a lot of people are thinking they've got to, you know, have this big grand promo video, or they've got to have all this sort of all these graphics and everything else. But I'm sorry, but it's the content that is key when you want to market your business and you want to build rapport and trust with people. Once people start getting free information and feel great about what you're telling them and make their day better, you are in their minds as somebody that it could be trusted and someone eventually they would want to buy from.
Yeah. And it's really powerful just to get on with it and not overanalyze it, isn't it? And
Hugely, yeah.
And people like Gary Vee are a great example of that, because a lot of his videos, even though they are very professional and they got sort of professional titles, a lot of it is just him on his phone talking into his phone and you know, doing it in that way. And so it just goes to show you don't have to overthink it with the video production. It is okay just to talk into the phone.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. But I mean, if you do have time, it's a lot of it comes down to time. If you do have time to make it a little bit more, you know, fancy, brilliant. If you get, you know, have the budget to hire someone to do a promo video or cover your events, brilliant, do all that. But actually, if you're not doing anything at all, that's where you've got to start. That's where you've got to talk to your audience. And you've got a lot of people, like I say, want it all glamorous. But actually, I would happily buy something from someone on a shaky, blurry live video, just as long as their message is on point and either makes me feel more intelligent or happier. You know, and there's other emotions you can mix into that. But those two are the key. Make me feel more intelligent, make me feel happier. You've got the perfect video.
Yeah. That's right. And also, it reminds me of like the idea that you don't need to be perfect before you begin anything. There's this that you can get into this procrastination zone where you think, I'm not ready. I'm not quite ready. I'll be ready soon. I'll do it when I'm ready.
Yes.
And there's that never ending waiting for perfection. And the reality is, if you just get on with it, and the worst thing that can happen, let's say you put up a video and it's not very good. What's the worst thing that can happen? No one's going to watch it and you just take it down again. Like, there's no harm done.
Exactly. Well, the thing is, if you have a video and it doesn't do anything, it's actually one of the best things for you. You go back, you watch it, and you go, why didn't it work? And actually, you know, when a crap video can do you the world of good, because you're not going to make that mistake again. You know, yeah, so go on.
No, I was going to say, like, I think speaking to camera and being on camera, it's like anything else. There's a process of kind of practicing. Like, it takes time to hone that skill. You know, like, video number one is not going to be your best video. And over time, you know, when I look back, I remember the first time I recorded myself doing guitar online, and the first time you listen to yourself and your voice sounds horrible and you look, you know, you don't like the way you look, and it's like, oh my God, I look fat, I'm ugly, my voice is horrible, I got a stupid Bristolian accent, and there's that initial thing that you got to get past. But as you do it more and more, it gets smoother, you get more comfortable, and it's like anything, it doesn't happen straight away.
No, absolutely not. I mean, I'm not a very good runner now, but I used to be an amazing runner. But believe it or not, I couldn't run for the bus at one point. And I feel that's the same with anything. You know, you're not going to be perfect to start with. Everything we do, we learn. You know, we had to be taught how to walk when we were a baby. But tell you what, you know, we could all walk. Well, most of us can walk now, you know. So everything is a learning process. But I think what it is with video particularly is, let's say we record a video and we're talking to a camera, it's an inanimate object. There's no one there giving you that reaction or telling you how well you're doing, or you know, you can't read somebody's emotions. And there's a long way to go, you know, to find out whether you're any good at it or not. And I think a lot of us put ourselves down, like you know, in that initial, you know, like you said, being ugly, feeling, you know, like they're, you know, gibbering on, I'm an RN, things like that. People hate it. But actually, the more you do it, the more you perfect those, and the more you get used to the process. And a lot of people just won't do it. Like you said, they just want it to be perfect. They want to think, you know, scripting is the worst for me, when people script something and it feels so unnatural. I'm sorry, but you know, there is a case of actually doing it, practice, and give it 6 months and you're going to be spot on.
Mm. Tell us about, you got events and like you do like training workshops and stuff. So what's coming up?
Okay, so if you were to head to www.jackcooke.com, healthy little plug there. I've got a video with confidence workshop coming up in January. The first one is in January. And it is about getting those people, the more stubborn, the more shy they are, the more they hate being in front of the camera. They've got 3 hours with me and a group of others to get from A to B and take that first step into creating video. There's going to be strategies, there's going to be tips, and people are going to walk away. I know they're going to walk away and they're just going to be, wow, this is going to change everything for me. It's going to help me grow my business, because so many of us market, but a load of, you know, it's got to be about 55% of good marketing can be based on video. And so many people are missing out just because of their own fears and their own hurdles, that actually I want them to get over it. I want them to look at the problems they put in front of themselves, why they put it in front of themselves, and just realize it's a load of, can I swear, crap? It's a load of crap, get over it. But not so harsh. I need people to understand the reasons we put these hurdles in front of them, and actually what the triggers that are involved with that, and how we're just gonna, you know, stop them from happening. But again, it's baptism of fire. You know, with this workshop, they will be doing videos by the end.
That's great. So what I love about it is, some aside from your enthusiasm, but it's aimed at people that are complete beginners that don't know where to begin. Yep. And you're really sort of like, so to speak, taking them by the hand showing them how to do it.
Yes. I mean, you know, you could be a complete beginner. That's fine. There are people that are going to be in the room that are not complete beginners, but they need the strategies and tips. There's so much for everyone throughout this course. You, Ben, are a veteran of it, so you probably wouldn't get a hell of a lot out of it. You'd probably be pretty bored, but you know, there's tons of people out there that aren't. And yes, taking them through that and guiding them through it, and it's really passionate for me, because it's personal development for these people, and there's going to be a sense of achievement. And for me, all those things, you know, we all appreciate that in our own lives, and I want to give these people something that they've probably been putting off for too long, and they're finally going to walk away and go, wow, my business is going to grow.
Mm. Yeah, in a funny kind of way, I can really relate, because when I teach handstands, what I enjoy is the people that are a bit nervous, that don't feel very confident, perhaps they don't feel good about their body, or they don't feel like they're strong, they don't feel like they're capable, you know, that kind of thing. I really love the process of teaching people handstands. Really is just, it's almost like it's just an excuse to get people feeling better about themselves and feeling more capable in themselves. And that's what I enjoy about it is, as well, it's that emotional self-image side of it that I love as well. Because in some ways, like if like a professional gymnast or a competitive gymnast comes along, or like a professional circus acrobat, I don't give a fuck about that person. They're fine. They, you know, they're doing their thing. They got their career. They're fine. Fuck off. You know, it doesn't interest me, and that's not what I cater to. What I love is really helping the people that feel a bit vulnerable. Because I remember, because when I first met you, you were working in the gym, and that's where I first met you. You're a personal trainer, right. And I started going to the gym. Now, when I first started going to the gym, I did not feel self-confident about exercise at all. I was too self-confident to go near the weights. I just went on the treadmill, and that was all I could handle emotionally. That's all I could handle. The idea of going and lifting weights, that was too overwhelming. I didn't know what I was doing. I felt like people were looking at me. I was really, even though it's hard to imagine now because I'm so comfortable in fitness environments now, but that's how I felt at the time. And I never forget that. And I always think, you know, when people come along to something new, like whether it's your workshop or whether it's my workshop, I always remember that's how they feel, you know, and that's really what we're helping people with, isn't it?
Absolutely. I've always said, you know, financially, it's great. You know, I can earn money from this, which, you know, I'm very privileged. If I won the lottery tomorrow, I'd do it for free. You know what I mean? Because of those, that's it. Getting people over those hurdles. We've all been scared of something in our lives. I mean, for me, leaping into business was a scary, scary thing, because there's a lot I was leaving behind and leaving on the table in order to pursue something I really wanted to do. And that's such a scary moment, and we all go through that in our, you know, through our lives and different things. So for me, of course, having people get over that video, you know, anxiety, should I say, and being a better person for it, because I've had an influence on them. That's more rewarding than any financial gain that I could ever have, because I just love people, and I love people being the best that they can be. I know you do that with your handstand classes, and now your journey as well, is making people be the best that they can be.
Yeah, that's great, isn't it? And so, besides the workshop that you're teaching, you also sort of you do bespoke services for business as well, and I guess it depends on what they need, because the stuff you do for me, I'm a little bit unusual, because I can do the video editing myself, and all I need is for you to be a cameraman for me, so that's specific to my situation. But then for other businesses, they'll have different requirements. So, like, give us some examples of things you've done for people.
I mean, that's such a huge variety. I had to do some testimonials recently for a gentleman. I went to one of his clients. He has a shredding business, and he needed a client testimonial for LinkedIn. So I went and interviewed their staff. He wasn't there, so I had to make myself, you know, introduce myself to the team and get them, you know, let them know me and feel relaxed with me before I could get them in front of the camera. So that was one thing. You know, yesterday I was doing an event, so I was filming a Christmas party for this big network in the Southwest. But right down to just doing small 1 minute Instagram videos, should we say, for other businesses. I've also done audio, and I'm starting to mess around now with doing screen grabbing for, you know, people's websites.
Screen grabbing? Down.
So, I'll explain that. So there's a gentleman that has a website. He'd like people to have the instruction on what to go through in order to find a certain service on the website and how to interact with that web page. So I'm going to be working with him soon, creating a video that's basically me using the website, and I will, you know, screen grab and film.
See, you're gonna film what you're like the mouse on the film, like the mouse on the screen and stuff.
Exactly. So he can then send that off as a 1 minute video to guide his potential clients through to where they need to be. So I think it's a little bit complicated. It's going to be a little bit of voiceover there as well for him to explain what he's doing.
Now,
But sorry, go on.
I was going to say, in terms of location, you're based in Bristol,
Yes.
Southwest England. So if there's people listening to this that are in different parts of the world and they can't necessarily come and meet you in person, what can you do online, remotely for people? Do you like what have you got available?
Yeah, so remotely, before we get into this, I am based in Bristol. I'm happy to travel. There's always costs involved in that, but always if people like my work and I'm willing to travel anywhere. LA or New York could be fine. So just send me there. Pay for my ticket. But anyway, so yeah, so what I can do remotely and I enjoy doing now, I think it's 85% of videos with subtitles. Oh, sorry, we watch 85% more videos with subtitles than without. Just because, we're always watching videos on the go in a busy environment where we probably can't listen to the sound. So subtitles win when it comes to videos. Everyone should be putting them on their videos. I do that. So somebody can send me their video that they filmed, and I will subtitle it for them for, quite a reasonable, affordable price. And I also do branding, so if they want their video, turned into a square, that we see a lot, especially on Instagram, I can mess about and jig videos, brand their videos as well, put titles on the beginning and end. If people are not savvy with what they can do, but they can record their own videos, I'm happy for them to send it to me, and I can do subtitling, branding, change the shape of the video, turn it into different variety of videos and editing as well, just as long as they've got the footage available.
I will tell the listeners, if you work with JD, by the way, JD, like where does the initials, is that your middle name, Jack? Is that?
It isn't. Before, I'll let you carry on a sec, but I'm not going to say what it is. But when I
Okay.
was younger, my dad had a little baby name for me, right? And as I grew up, it became he shortened it to JD because that was a little bit cooler than the baby name. And
Okay.
I always said I'll keep it. I use it somewhere in my career, and that's where it came from.
Okay,
Yeah, I'll tell you off.
because I know you as JD and Jack, so like sometimes I call you both. But I will tell people if they're considering working with you, or they're considering getting you in to do that, you have an enthusiasm and a positivity that is really, really great to be around and helpful as well. Like from a practical standpoint, you filmed my events where we've done all day things where we were there like all day, we've gone in the car together and then we're there like it's like a 7 8 hour event. There's dance teachers, there's yoga teachers, there's caterers, there's 20, and you're on the ball from start to finish. You're getting testimonials from people like in between the activity. Like I might finish teaching handstands and then you're scurrying around asking people for interviews, getting testimonials. Like you really put 100% like effort in to helping me get what I need, because that that's what's really stands out about Jack Cooke. Because it's one thing having some, like, somebody buys an expensive camera, they got some nice equipment, they bought an expensive microphone, and they come along. But without that enthusiasm and without, like, if you've got someone filming, they need to understand what you need for your marketing. And that's one thing. You understand what I need or what your other clients need, and you make sure you get it on camera. And that is invaluable, you know?
I really, really appreciate you saying that. I mean, you are great to work with. Your enthusiasm in these groups makes it easy for me to film as well, I must say. But for me, it is everything's about passion. I think you know this as well. For me, everything's got to be about passion. I absolutely love what I do, and I love seeing other people's lives and your lives with handstands and the trainers that you bring into these workshops and these days, just to see what they do. So for me, that really sort of excites me, and I do like to see it from your potential customers' point of view as well. I'd like to see it, from what do people want to hear? What do people want to know? How is it going to change them when they see this video later on down the road? For me, that's really exciting, and I really appreciate you saying that because I think if anyone is not enthusiastic about what they do, they need to get out and do something they are enthusiastic about doing because it makes 8 hour, 9 hour days a lot more exciting, than just turning up an 8 hour, 9 hour job.
So, your background. You've done all kinds of different stuff over the years. So
Yes.
give us your backstory.
Okay, where do I start? I never thought I was an entrepreneur. Like a lot of people have these kind of these stories, you know. Used to sell sweets. Is that right, Ben?
I did when I was little. Yeah, I was a sweet hustler. I
Yeah.
was a good boy. I never did drugs and nothing. That was, but sweets I could. That was in my comfort zone. Yeah.
See, I never thought I really had that. And then when I look back, I realized that, you know, when I was 8 years old, I was creating my own stories, you know, story books, and me and my mate were selling them at markets. They were kind of a Goosebumps ripoff, but made out of A4 paper and painted with PVA to make it look glossy. And I was looking back, and I figured, you know, that was an entrepreneurial thing. And there was so many of these little jobs, like car washing. I used to walk around the village car washing. I used to turn up at farms and say, "What can I do for a couple of quid, you know, per job or whatever?" And the more I think about it, I've always been a natural hustler. I always knew how to get money or make money. So that's where it all started, really. But when I was, I've been picking up cameras since I was about 11, as and when I could, and messing about with them. Certainly, I enjoyed doing plays and things like that. So I enjoyed directing people, my brothers in particular, as much as they didn't appreciate that. For me, that's where it kind of started. And then I actually started my first video business when I was about 18. And that was pretty much just going to local small projects around my village and saying, "Look, I've got a camera. You haven't got anybody filming this. How much do you want to pay me to come and do it?" And that's where it kind of started. And then that moved on. You know, I'm always somebody that jumps on opportunities. I make sure if I want to do something, I go out there and I bloody do it, and I try my best to get myself in a position. And I started working for a couple of television companies. I had a small career, but certainly an eventful one, in television for some time. Still doing some of my side hustling with my own video projects, making money on the side. But then things turned a little bit too corporate, and I realized that my creative side, my people loving, you know, person side, personal side, is it was. It wasn't there anymore, and I wasn't enjoying what I was doing, and I wasn't enthusiastic about getting the next job, so I wasn't really trying for anything. And realized that actually fitness was my second in command, I suppose, when it came to hobbies. And this is when we met, is when I decided that actually I want to do that now. And then I realized what the trigger was again, we were talking about it earlier, it's just how much I loved working with people. And I had It was elderly people and people that were overweight were the two, like not severely overweight, but people that really needed to lose weight just for their to better their health. And these were the people I was enthusiastic about. If, you know, someone came in and they were an avid runner and they just wanted to lift weights, I'd help them, but I wasn't that excited because they could probably pick up a book and pick it up themselves. And so, yeah, I realized there was this passion for people. And talking to people and about their stories and what brought them to, you know, this place where they're overweight, or you know, maybe their history, you know, if they're elderly, you know, they've got a lot of stories to tell. I loved it, absolutely loved it. And then decided to go traveling in the end. There's only so much you could do, and I'm an avid traveler. I love seeing the world, so I went traveling. Came back, had some horrible jobs. That after 2.5 years came back and had some horrible jobs, didn't like some crap bosses as well. I'll tell you what, if you're a crap boss, everybody hates you, quit, do them a favor and do yourself a favor. You're obviously not in the job you want. Sorry, I'm not gonna go off, but yeah, honestly, some people just aren't made to be bosses, but they've been given a position. And then I lost a job after a trial. Nothing bad, it just wasn't for me. I realized that now, and I went, you know what, sod it, I'm a creative guy. I love technology, so social media is my first go-to. I really wanted to learn it inside and out, which has benefited me no end when it came to the video. I'm gonna start my own business. I'm gonna be happy. I'm not just gonna do a job because I want to pay for next, you know, next year's holiday. I'm gonna do a job that pays for next year's holiday. But actually, I'm not looking forward to the holiday because I actually got a few jobs I wouldn't mind doing before then, you know, and be excited about the job tomorrow rather than thinking, oh, I can't wait for 6 weeks to pass. before I can put my feet up and do nothing. Because, yeah, and that's landed me where I am today. So, yes, you know, natural entrepreneur, natural hustler, knew how to make money, definitely a natural creative that loves making films. And that's me in a nutshell. And it's worked out very well for me.
You've done acting and like story writing and stuff as well, right?
That's right. Yes, yeah, acting. I've done a few, nothing big, just sort of Amdram stuff. But I have, I've been in like extras and in a few things. And here's the best one. This was a good one. I was asked to do a thing with British Aerospace up at Filton in Bristol. And they asked me to do, basically we had to act out all these different scenarios. And one of them, I had to play a terrorist on a plane. I think I was pretty good at it. Well, apparently I was pretty good at it, because if anybody remembers, there was it was Heathrow liquid bomb, event that happened. And that's when they stopped all liquids going through the airport and that. I kept getting like loads of text messages. Why are you on TV? And they had used the terrorist footage all over the BBC, ITV, and it was me trying to get into the cabin of a plane. Yeah, smashing on the door, taking my belt off, whacking people with it, all the sorts.
What? Were they pretending that was the real footage of the event?
Not quite, but anybody knew me or understood TV would have like got it. But if Facebook wasn't huge at the time, but I would imagine that a few stupid people might have got the wrong idea. Oh, I didn't get punched for it in the street, so that was good.
All right. Oh, crikey. Okay, so yeah. So when you decided you've only been running your business sort of not long, like less than a couple of years, and when you first started out, I mean, it's going well now, but when you first started out, what was your state of mind? Like, were you confident about how it was going to go, or were you nervous? Like, what was it like to begin?
No, not at all. Hated it. I say that. You can't hate the process, because looking back, it was a good time, a good learning curve for me. But I was nervous as hell. And I was working a really crap job to support it as well at the time when I first started. And I almost felt like when the phone doesn't ring and you're not getting any emails, but you've got this perfect idea that's going to be brilliant. Mm. When you're walking around and you've got leaflets in your hand and you're going door to door to all these businesses and people sort of just turn their nose up at you, this is a horrible feeling. And that was the first 3 months until a couple of people said, I'll give you a chance. I'm not going to pay you much. I'm like, fine. And this was social media to start with. And I was making peanuts. I was still working this other job. And then as I sharpened my tools, I got a bit more confident, started to get a bit more confident with selling it, started to get a bit more confident with going to these meetings, you know, and telling them, outlining what they're going to get for their money. And then I had a portfolio of clients. And then you look back over those 3 to 6 months prior and you think, I was scared, witless, that this was all going to fail. And I've already told everybody, I'm starting a business, which is, if you're an entrepreneur, don't do it. Just go and start the business. Don't tell everyone, because there's, you know, too much relying on you for that. So I obviously turned it into something that is, and it's just perseverance. And actually, I think is scary is something I'm excited about as well. So, I didn't like it at all in that sense. But looking back, I'm glad I bloody did it, you know, which is actually a strong message that I really try to preach with people that start a business for the first time. And they go out and they think it's all going to work out because they've got the perfect idea. And you can relate this back to doing video, is you might have this perfect idea about how it's all going to work and it doesn't. And you've got to change your strategy as well. Things had to change a little bit here and there to suit the clients that I was looking for. I couldn't be romantic about the fact that my idea was brilliant. If people don't want it, then they don't want it. You can't change that. But yeah, if to any business, any entrepreneur that thinks I'm gonna start a business, you have to give it those 2 years. I thought it was a myth. Give it 2 years to get it off the ground and make it work, and work hard. And when you have a really crap day, just go, what am I gonna do today to make tomorrow much better? And I had to tell myself that every day for those first 3 to 6 months before things really started picking up.
Yeah, you really have to dig deep because everyone, it's easy when things are going well and you can see somebody who's successful and they're making it look easy. It's when it's not going well. That's when you really have to you find out what you're made of, isn't it? Like stay like keeping what's the word? Like sort of keeping the faith, staying focused. Sticking to it when things are tough, that's what really makes the difference, isn't it?
Oh, hugely. You have to, because that is make or break. And I'm guessing, somewhere along the line, if people bow their heads out after 3 to 6 months, maybe it just wasn't ever going to be for them. And maybe that's what separates people. Maybe they do just need to have a job and have guidance, every day. Or, there's other people that probably give up and they should have kept going. But what I will say, I'll repeat it all the time, is you've got to adapt, because you can't, like I said, you can't be romantic about what you want to sell and you expect people to buy that from you, because it ain't gonna work. Your idea might be brilliant and then make millions of pounds. You're fine, but 9 times out of 10, you're gonna have to change things slightly, make it a little bit different here and there, and don't be like so structured, because it's just gonna collapse around you. And it would have done if I hadn't changed my strategy intact. The fact I'm doing video now, not social media, is because I realized there was a stronger calling for video over social media, and I had to adapt to that. Fortunately, I love doing it, so win-win, really.
It reminds me of the analogy of an aeroplane, because an aeroplane is constantly like adjusting its direction to constantly to like to keep aiming towards a target. They don't just set the flaps and then just leave it. You
That's
know,
it.
it's a
Oh,
constant
yeah.
adjustment all the way until you get there, isn't it? And I think it's
Yeah.
the same with anything in life, with any goal, isn't it? You're constantly tweaking.
Absolutely. I think that's a really good analogy, actually. Yeah, absolutely. If you get rough waters when you're sailing, then you're gonna have to, turn around sometimes and go the other way. But for me, like, I'm really glad it did change. And I'll tell you what, the biggest thing for me now, because when I look back and think I'm glad I changed and did things a little bit differently, is we're reaching Christmas now. And this is the first Christmas that I've been very financially stable. I'm very excited about Christmas because I'm not worrying about the money I have to spend or will spend. There's times when I would, get 250 quid and that'd be blown on making sure, I had presents or, money for food. I did, and that's taken 2.5 years to get to this place. But for me, that was a real goalpost that I've reached, in the fact that actually I feel really good. I've got money in the bank. I've got a business, in January. I'm financially stable and happy. Happy is what we do it all for.
Fantastic. That's really great. That's really great. That's cool. So let's start to wrap up. So if people want to get in contact with you, so just remind us again, what's the best way to find you?
So easiest way is www.jackcookwithane.com, CookE.com. So I've got all my details on there. I'll be adding bits and pieces to the website as well. If they want to find my business beyond the brand, on any of the social media platforms, it is at Beyond Films UK, on all the major social media platforms. Some I'm a bit more active on than others, but you'll find something there that'll be of interest.
And also, if people want to see examples of Jack's filming, if you go to circaplex.com, which is my website, you can find loads of handstand videos there that was all filmed by
Brilliant.
Jack. So that's another
Yes.
example.
Yeah,
Wicked.
thank
All
you.
right, JD. Thanks for taking the time to tell us
No,
about
it's
all
been
that.
brilliant. really glad I can get involved, my friend. Thank you very much for having me on. Looking forward to hearing more of these podcasts, and there's so many great guys out there that you're interviewing, so really looking forward to it, mate.
Awesome. Okay, thanks for now, and I'll speak to you soon.
See you soon. Cheerio.
Cheers, bye.